Hi, my name is Marianne, and my work presentation is about rigor mortis and what it involves. So, what is rigor mortis? Rigor mortis, also known as postmortem rigidity, is normally understood as a muscle contraction of the whole body or just part of it, beginning in the muscles of the face and neck. And during this time, the muscle stiffens in a way that it becomes impossible to move them. It happens due to chemical changes in our body. So, when the person is alive, there's a mechanism that happens, and every time a contraction occurs, it needs a sufficient amount of ATP or adenosine triphosphate and calcium stored in a muscle. These are two important elements to the process of muscular contraction, and ATP, being this our primary source of energy, is also important not only to contraction but also to elasticity of the muscle. These two elements always work together when it comes to muscular contraction. And when we talk about the work of the muscles, we talk about the sliding filament theory. So, in this theory, our muscles have two major kinds of filaments: the actin filament, that is normally locked, and the myosin filament. Every time a muscle is contracted, the ends of the myosin bind to the actin, and when this happens, they contract and pull the filaments in so they get smaller. This is called the sliding filament theory. Normally, the actin filaments are locked, so they can't bind with the myosin filaments, and that's where calcium comes in. Calcium normally is stored in the muscle cells. And when it's time for muscle contraction, calcium is released. And this one is the key to unlock the filaments of actin. Meanwhile, we also need one nucleotide of ATP that allows for the myosin filaments to go into position and bind with the actin filaments and pull those in. After death, so post-death, initially calcium is released in huge quantities, which determines normally a cellular death and unlocks all the actin filaments, making it available for the myosin filaments to bind. And then there's a huge decrease on calcium and also a large decrease on ATP. So the remaining ATP helps throughout this binding and at the same time decreases. So when the muscle wants to relax, it can't because there's no more ATP stored. And this nucleotide is very important not only to contraction but also to the muscular relaxation. After that, we have then when we enter the stage of rigor mortis. It's well known that immediately after that, the body enters a stage of relaxation, which can be referred as the first stage of rigor mortis. And in this position, the body can be easily moved around and change from its initial position. Then we have the second stage, that is when rigor mortis is initiated, normally 2 hours after death. And in here, the body can no longer be moved, so the position of the body before rigor mortis is the position that remains. The third stage involves the duration of rigor mortis, and this is very variable because rigor mortis is affected by a lot of factors, but normally can last up to 24 hours. Rigor mortis brings a lot of advantages for forensics investigation on someone's death, since they can help determine the time of death and the body position during this time, making the forensics aware if whether the body was moved by another person or not. So, a few studies have helped determine a lot of factors that can indeed interact with the duration of rigor mortis, including when it sets in and when it ends. And in here are a few factors. We have age, body temperature, environmental temperature, illness, body fat, and intoxication with stimuli. Age is an important factor because this event seems to appear more rapidly on people of a younger or older age whose muscular mass is lacking. Also, situations where the temperature is too high, for example, high temperature on the body, can lead to denaturation of proteins, and this decreases ATP. Also, illness, including infections, can lead to a rapid onset of rigor mortis when the person dies. And we have, for example, excessive body fat can slow down this biochemical mechanism. And it's important to add that if someone is under the effect of a stimulant drug or died from an intoxication with stimulants such as cocaine or amphetamines, their rigor mortis onset is anticipated. Environmental temperature is a very important factor to acknowledge since being in different countries with different environmental temperatures can also change the delay of rigor mortis on each person differently. So these are a few references that I used for this paper. And thank you, and I hope you enjoyed.